This country is beautiful, one of the best surely on the face of the earth, but we got problems like anyone else that we must resolve. And this Black Lives Matter movement, I wish them well. And I think that they're gonna give us some production. I really do, I really do.
In the morning and I ask myself, is life worth living, should I blast myself? I'm tired of being poor and even worse, I'm black. My stomach hurts, so I'm looking for a purse to snatch. Cops give a damn about a negro. Pull a trigger, kill a nigga, he's a hero. Get it back to the kids who...
I think it's an important movement. I think the fact that we have to have it is of concern, because this is not a new phenomenon. There have been concerns about the way in which African Americans are treated in America since its inception, and the unnecessary violence and killing of young black men by law enforcement officials is very troubling, particularly in the 21st century, where most people think we've moved beyond that, but apparently we have not. So I think it's important primarily for those individuals who are the victims of unnecessary assaults and violence by any state agency or government official, including law enforcement. And so I think it's beneficial, and I think it has helped many African Americans feel that to some extent they have a voice. The question is what type of measurable outcomes will it produce? But again, I think as a whole, I think it's a beneficial phenomenon.
I think the Detroit community already realized Black Lives Matter. You know, we just don't have any public advertisement when it comes to the shooting or killing of one of our children. How many community groups do rally around those people and their families? Like our Detroit 300 group, they never got any really serious acknowledgement for their finding of rapists, ex-killers, people, you know, closing down drug houses, stuff like that. So the Black Lives Matter is a lot in Detroit. It's a lot of groups that's doing preventative maintenance, so to speak, like New Era Detroit. Like I did mention Detroit 300, but I don't know if they're still in operation. But it's a lot of different groups. It Takes a Village is another group. A lot of these groups look for lost children. They do their own personal security patrols in their own community, you know, because we have a problem with young girls going to school being raped early in the morning time. So it's a lot of stuff that's going on that doesn't get portrayed in the news. So I think the Black Lives Matter movement in Detroit is very serious.
Well, I think the Black Lives Matter has met their agenda. I think their agenda was to be recognized, their voices to be heard, and I think they were successful in that. However, I do think Black Lives Matter should not be a movement for black people. I think it should be a movement for non-Africans. Because for so long, we have been trying to convince other people that our lives matter. And to me, I think that is preposterous. The reason I say that is that we're in a day and age where it's pretty much safe to say that black people bleed. Black people are the original people. We've been here for, you know, X amount of centuries. Why should we have to let other ethnicities or other groups of people know that we are human and that they should value our lives? We've been doing that since the Emancipation Proclamation. So with that being said, there are white people that do know Black Lives Matter. That should be their movement, because they can go into areas where we cannot go. They can go into social gatherings where non-Africans can feel comfortable socially and really be themselves. They might even use the N-word casually. With that being said, that should be the platform for non-Africans, because to me, activism is going out of your comfort zone. When you're doing the movement here in the community, you're saying Black Lives Matter, you're preaching to the choir. Right? If we want to show Black Lives Matter, then black people within ourselves, we need to show it among each other and doing community work in our area. It shouldn't come out only when a black person, a cop kills a black person, and then you see Black Lives Matter. Then when you look down and you see some other brothers getting killed, you don't see the Black Lives Matter. We need to show each other that we value each other. It doesn't matter what they think, because if they haven't shown any progress how they treat us, then that should be something that they have to work on themselves. We can't help counsel that, because we have a lot of other issues ourselves. We have Stockholm syndromes, post-traumatic slavery. We have a lot of other tangible problems, black-on-black crime, poverty. There's a million issues that we have to deal with. Why should we exhaust our energy letting them know that our lives matter?
Let me say off the cuff, I truly believe all lives matter. Cops not only abuse blacks, probably 90% of the time they might be abusing blacks, but poor whites are also abused by police. You see, in this capitalistic society, if you are poor, you are subject to be discriminated against, no matter whether you're white or black. They will go in and they'll call the poor whites trailer trash. And they actually will go into the poor white neighborhoods and assault them just as they would the average black. They would assault them just as they would with the average black. We've seen that time and time and time again. So it's the capitalistic society, it's about a status too. Mm-hmm. It's not only racism, it's a status of how much money you make, where you live, whether you white or black. In this country. So the poor white man is getting his ass kicked too. The only difference is the rich white guy is telling the poor white guy that you are better than the black folk.
Wow, this is interesting.
And would you believe he believes it? Yeah. he actually believes it while he's getting his ass kicked. He thinks, oh, you kick my ass, but I'm better than the blacks. Yeah. No. You ain't better than the blacks. You actually worse than they are, because you are taking that and not even complaining about it.
Mistreatment by police officers. Detroit historically is known. Police officers get killed in Detroit. Let's just keep it real, okay? So when things happen, like you know, the police brutality, it's a lot of different elements that will attack that. You know what I'm saying? This is not a passive city. If a brother like, for instance, I can't think of his name. Like the brother who got choked out in New York for the cigarettes. If any of his other brothers or cousins on that same street would have seen the police doing that, they would have shot at the police. This is not that type of city. And that's where the problem with the, you know, with the movement is that our voice is not being heard. You know, we don't have enough politicians, lawyers, attorneys on this situation because they bought and bossed. We don't have enough people that's unbought and unbossed.
It's not a good, doesn't send a good message or a positive message to African Americans in general and young African Americans in particular, because they develop an attitude or perspective or view of law enforcement that is not conducive to social order, and it's not conducive to creating communities that are cooperative with law enforcement. So I think that the unnecessary violence and assaults on innocent civilians obviously creates a great deal of animus and anger and frustration in young African-American males, and they're less likely to cooperate with police, even sometimes when it's in their best interest to, or in the best interest of their community, to cooperate.
The race riots, you know, that's the most popular one, and that came from police. You know, they came and they raided one of the bars, arrested some black men, and that caused a huge, you know, huge outrage. And what was our response to that? Basically, we riot. We had, you know, messed up our businesses somewhat, you know, had violence with the cops and everything. But the aftermath came out of that was people were so galvanized by the atrocities that was committed on black people that you had Mayor Coleman Young come in office in 1972. Because right after the 1967, you had the stress unit, right? The stress unit, what was it? Safe enjoy safe streets, something like that. You had the stress unit, which was a police force unit, specialized for those people after the riot. They specialized in trying to basically mitigate any kind of activism coming after the race riot. And they were successful. They killed more black men than any other police force at that time. But when Mayor Comey Young got in office, they immediately dismantled it. He integrated the police force by 50% black. Police killings were minimized at a very high rate.
Lack of jobs, poor infrastructure that would allow people to actually be able to get back and forth to work. There are jobs available, not enough. They don't pay well enough for people to support themselves in any type of adequate fashion. But you have to have the infrastructure. You have to have city services such as bus systems that run regularly to count on getting back and forth to work. Many, many people in Detroit, like in most cities, in most places, want to work. And there may be jobs somewhere, but not being able to afford a car, they need good public transportation. And Detroit doesn't have that. So I think that what holds Detroit back is an infrastructure that can support working people. And of course, the bottom line is you have to have jobs. And every time, you know, a large company or corporation advertises, you know, 100, 200 jobs, you get thousands of people who apply. And there are, many of them are very qualified, but there aren't enough jobs for them. So that's a problem. You mentioned mass incarceration. Well, mass incarceration, by that we mean the excessive incarceration of American citizens, primarily black and brown citizens, has had a devastating effect on cities like Detroit. It undermines family structure, it undermines the city. These individuals return to their communities affected negatively by their incarceration, not to mention the fact that now they have lost some of their rights, their right to get licenses for certain occupations. They've lost their voting rights to a certain extent over periods of time. They have this big mark on their record, and every employer, no matter how minor or low on the employment totem pole that job may be, want to know if you have a felony record. And if you do, then they can decide not to give you a chance, even if you're qualified to work for them. So it has a tremendous impact on people. It has tremendous impact on succeeding generations when they see young men and older men going back and forth to prison, because that takes role models out of that community. It also weakens the community with regard to having the natural healthy family structures and healthy communities that can protect those communities and families from that small percentage of individuals out there who want to do harm, be they drug dealers, other type of offenders who prey upon these poor communities that don't have, you know, healthy functioning men or enough healthy functioning men just there, and they're away in prison. So the excessive incarceration of young men over the last 35, 40 years has had a devastating effect on cities like Detroit in so many ways.
There's gentrification of the city of Detroit. So no city services will be amplified or be more beneficial to the urban community. We just had a discussion on the redlining of car insurance and homeowners insurance in the city of Detroit. It's a form of gentrification. They're utilizing your economic status to detach you from the community, because if you can't afford to live there, then you have to leave. So for me personally, I don't think the services are changing. I think the city landscape is changing. I think a lot of our black leaders and organizers and groups, they're coming more into the city as opposed to downtown, which they're really trying to turn into a military zone. If you haven't observed downtown, it's the streets are directed in different directions. The police corral of all the homeless people, you know, in and out of the area. You know, it's a lot that's going on, but the gentrification of the city of Detroit is not moving us forward like it's supposed to.
They gave you a process of bankruptcy. We took bankruptcy, and now the city's coming back. right out here in the streets there, those street lights were dark. I mean, completely dark. No lights at all up here for years, except my sign out there. Now you drive down the street and there are lights all along. All of this was really because of the bankruptcy. So we got rid of some of our debts. And then as a result of that, we are now investing back in the city. The city's coming back. Mm-hmm. I still call a New Center area Cass Quarter, because that's what it was. Mm-hmm. If people come in, they want to change the name. It's a little better, if you will. But no, to me, it's Cass Quarter.
Unity. Unity is the number one component. If we can unify, aggregate our resources, circulate our dollar, last year we spent $1.1 trillion. And out of the $1.1 trillion that was spent in America from black people, only 2% of private black-owned businesses was on the recipient end of that. Now, private black-owned businesses is the highest employer of black people in terms of private-owned businesses, yet they only receive 2%. So we have to change that. We have to circulate our dollar more. The black dollar in the community only lasts 6 hours. Within the Asians, it's 10 times. Within the Arabs, I believe it's 6 times. Probably longer. No, it's not 6 times. It's got to be longer than that. And then with white people, it's infinity. It stays because they own a lot of stuff. So that's a serious problem. We're the number one spenders, consumers, in the country, yet our dollar only lasts 6 hours at a minimum in our community. That's a serious problem. So we have to be unified. There's nothing wrong with us being unified and saying, listen, I'm going to spend with you, I'm going to collect because we're black. You know, I don't think there's nothing wrong with that. We still hold each other accountable though. Because just because it's a black business doesn't necessarily mean that his intentions are proven. We have to hold them accountable and make sure that they're giving back to the community and they're contributing to the cause. But ultimately, unity is what Detroit needs. We need unity, we also need accountability. Nobody's holding our leaders accountable. That's why you have the political leadership that's disenfranchised right now. You have the emergency matters and stuff, and that's why you have gentrification taking place. All these business owners downtown right now. Everybody's pro-black now because they're getting kicked out of their buildings. But back 20 years ago, when you knew that white people was coming to the, white-collar people was coming to the downtown, what were you doing then? Why didn't you form a co-op? You had the opportunity to have a co-op business where y'all could have bought these buildings if y'all couldn't afford it. And now, they're not selling these buildings. Why? Because they understand the importance of downtown. Downtown is a big money. It's a cash cow now. It's all types of money coming. So they're not going to sell you the building. They don't want you to have your business up there. They want you out so they can get whoever they want in there and get that money. So unity and accountability is what we need in the city of Detroit.
I hope that they learn that in many ways, attitudes towards African Americans have changed to some extent over the last generation and a half. I'm talking about 30, 40 years. But in many ways, it hasn't changed. And I think that young people need to know their history. I think that I would hope that the Black Lives Movement would learn their history, because there really is nothing new under the sun. I mean, what we see happening to African-American, young African-American males in the last 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 years, it's not new. It's common practices. It helped spark the Detroit riots in the 1960s. So, you know, here we are 50 years later, almost 50 years later, same issues, same problems. So I hope they understand that this is not something new. This and then therefore the causes are deeper than just a few, quote, rogue, unquote, police officers. There's an institutional issue here. And they have to understand where that comes from and what contributes to it in order to have any significant effect on it. Because just assuming that this is just, we have a rogue law enforcement community or a segment of a law enforcement community who are just going out and doing these things would really miss the boat. They would not really truly understand that this is not something that this is caused by a few rogue individuals. We have institutional arrangements in the society that allow these things to happen. And it is important to understand how that works, what the factors that contribute to that. And I think it'll help them better understand that you know, this is not the 1960s. You know, this is something very different in the sense that it's times have changed to the point where people feel comfortable allowing these things to happen and allowing the perpetrators of these types of crimes to go unpunished. And that's something I think a lot of young people are maybe surprised. They think this is something new, and they think this is a whole new movement. It's not. It's really not. So I hope that they learn, they look back and study the history of this country in that regard, and understand that this is not the exception. This has been the rule, and that you can probably go back 35 years ago and see cases just like this. You know, and maybe people were less sensitive to it, or maybe we framed it in a different context or a different way, but this has been the plight of African Americans since they first came here.
Hopefully, the youth will become more informed about the world, because the problem is that the elders been around already. They know what's going on. They know when it happened, you know, in the 1960s, 70s, 50s, 40s, whatever, and they looking for the movement to shift into a different direction, but the youth don't realize the history of the police brutality, of all the different scenarios and situations that had already happened, like the 67 riots, you know, the riots in, 47, I think it is, Tulsa, Oklahoma, you know, the different things that impacted us when we had our Black Wall Streets. You know, people don't realize, and our young people should realize this, that look at every major metropolitan city where all the freeways at. All the freeways were actually the zoning areas where our major Black Wall Streets were. Like in Detroit, we had our Black Bottom, they put a freeway through it. In Chicago, they had their area, they put a freeway through it. In Philly, they had an area, they put a freeway through it. Even in D.C., they put a freeway straight through their Black Wall Street area. So it's an ongoing saga of making it look like we perpetually wasn't moving forward. But with the advent of us, what they call that, knocking out segregation and all of us unifying, it put a limitation on our growth as far as our economic status, our business status, and a lot of those climates, because we felt like we could come in and be a part. And I want to take one example, Jackie Robinson, when he joined into the major leagues, all of the black-owned baseball leagues, those started to fizzle off because everybody wanted to be a part of the major leagues. Well, the black-owned baseball leagues generated their own income, they had their own audience. You know, if they were a baseball league today, they would have their own syndicated television rights. You know, it would be all black-owned money being circulated. So that's what the problem is, you know. With the Black Lives Matter, and I understand that, you know, when Farrakhan went to D.C., he instituted that blackout on Christmas and all that, which is good. You know, we should take it a step further and do it all year round. You know, make it an effective statement rather than just a seasonal statement.
I think Black Lives Matter is a reactionary movement. I think the next step now is being proactive. That's what Detroit is about. We're out in the streets and we're implementing things that are preventative in regards to atrocity that's committed by police, by our own people, or anything. We're setting programs right now that are going to be entrenched in our community, whereas it's going to sustain action to prevent any other violence being committed on us. Kwame Ture, which is Mike Stokin Carmichael, who came up with the slogan Black Power, what he said is that a cop comes in the neighborhood and kills somebody. We can all go out and cause a ruckus and yell and talk about, you know, what they've done, and march and raise our hand. Anybody can do that. That's common. But to actually put in a program or have your people organized where you can sustain action, so if the police come, then we're able to defend and protect ourselves, that's proactive. That's being proactive. And that's what New Era Detroit is essentially about, is that we're trying to be proactive. We're trying to render consequences when you do take a black life, whether it's black, white, or any law enforcement.
Well, you know, I really don't think Black Lives Matter is going to move very far without hooking up with other organizations.
Okay.
So Black Lives Matter is going to have to hook up with the Muslims. They're going to have to hook up with the Jewish population. They're going to have to hook up with these other organizations in order to move their agenda forward. Because when we were in the Civil Rights Movement, we would not have made it if it had not been for Jews, it had not been for Muslims, had it not been for decent whites, Catholics. I picketed with Catholics back in the 60s to sit down at a restaurant, to eat at a restaurant. When I was born, you couldn't eat at a restaurant. But my father told me, he said, listen, We could not challenge this man because he would kill us and nothing would be done about it. He said, your generation must change this. And now I want you to listen to the Reverend and follow him. And that's how I got into the civil rights movement of picketing and became the president of the college, NAACP, and so forth. But you cannot do this by yourself, Black Lives Matter. You got to do it with a group of other individuals who think the same way you think. And the Catholics, the Jews, other decent Americans changed the civil rights movement. People ask me all the time, who is your greatest president, the hero? Lincoln and Lyndon Baines Johnson. They don't give him the credit that he deserved. President Johnson put, I went to college on his little work study program that he put out there for poor people to go to college in. And he never lied when he said, if we help them out now, they will help the country out later. And I think about the, I don't know, thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars of taxes that I have paid. That when you're in a country that spends more money on prisons than it does on education, it's gonna be a problem. Yes. Simple. So we, Black Lives Matter, got to join other groups. You gotta have those liaisons out there in order to exist in longevity.
It's time for us as a people to start making some changes. Let's change the way we eat, let's change the way we live, and let's change the way we treat each other. You see, the old way wasn't working, so it's on us to do what we gotta do to survive. And still I see no changes. Can a brother get a little peace? It's war on the streets and a war in the Middle East. Instead of